ask this simple question to ask, who are you? And you will give me an answer that maybe I'm thinking of and maybe not. So who are you? Can anyone answer that right now in one sentence, who you are? That's not a bad answer, but what else? If you'll put up your diagram, I would love to kind of step over here. If I had a whiteboard, I'd just draw it, but I don't. And we're not in the Tear Off the Roof series anymore. That's the wrong message. So that's all right. The other one should be on there. But throw up your diagram real quick. When I was watching this and when I heard this, this is what I thought. We're in the Word in our comfort zones. But Jesus was in the Word and on the edge. And we say here in our comfort zone, it is okay. Jesus is our example. But then when it comes to stepping out, we step in. I was speaking to a group yesterday, and they said, you know what? We invite people into the church, and I've always called that inreach. It's not bad. Hear me. It's not bad. I like that. That's good. Let's invite them to church. But in order to get them in the church to hear the Word of God, you have to go out to the edge. And a lot of you are doing that now. And a lot of you are creating that now. Who are you? I'm a child of God. Yes, but what else? What does that mean? What does that entail? How do you get from here, child of God, comfort zone child of God, to here, I'm breaking the rules of our society, but I'm living within the confines of the Word of God. And see, we're there. But we step up to the ledge and go, come get me. You can't cross this line. See, Satan doesn't want you here because you're getting too close to him. See, and God says, why live in the middle? Come get me. So who are you? Are you only just a child of God? That's big. Don't get me wrong. I'm not trying to downplay being a child of God. Yes, you are a child of God. But are you the feet? Are you the hands? Are you the eyes? Are you the mouth? What are you? And who are you? And how are you going to get your purpose out there? Do you belong in this world? I didn't add that. That was different. Questions come up when you start thinking, who am I? What makes you you? What makes you you? Think about that in a worldly term. What makes you you? How do people describe you? I was down at the coffee shop when I was writing this sermon, and I pulled some of the people aside, and I said, who are you? And they're like, well, I'm so-and-so. Right, but I know you. I've met you. But who would you say you are? I don't know. And I said, I invited someone over that knew him. And I go, well, who do you think this person is? In one sentence, tell me who they are. Well, I don't think they even know who they are. Well, then who are you? These are adults. These are people that are daily adulting. They're being adults. They're trying to figure it out. They're trying to belong. And they don't know it. And I have a funny feeling that when God gave me this, it wasn't just for the people at the coffee shop, but it was for you, saying, who are you in this world? We know who you are in heaven because God looks down and goes, child of God. But who are you for Christ in this world? Other questions that come up. Is someone trying to lead you? Are you following? Have you ever tried to be someone different than you really are supposed to be? It's a challenge, right? I haven't even gotten into the Word yet. Who are you? I mean, really, not just the facade of our outside living, but who are you privately? Because that says who you are to Christ. Romans 12, verse 1. Have you turned there if you have your Bibles? Otherwise, it's up here. It's a little smaller. Can you all read that? I'm sorry. I will make it bigger next time. So I'll read it to you. It's easy that way. Verse 1, it says this. It says, "And so, dear brothers and sisters, I plead with you to give your bodies to God because all he has done for you, let them be a living and holy sacrifice, the kind he will find acceptable. This is truly the way to worship him. Don't copy the behaviors and customs of the world, but let God transform you into a new person by changing the way you think. Then you will learn to know God's will for you, which is good and pleasing and perfect." Let's just stop there. Let's look at verse 2 again. Don't copy the behavior and customs of this world. I say something, and you'll probably hear this time and time and time again. Be culturally engaging while living a countercultural life. Be culturally engaging while living a countercultural life. Go to the edge and engage culture. But don't copy the behaviors and customs of this world. Can you encounter culture by going to the bar but not participate in what the world participates in? Simple question. When I grew up, I remember a lot of the people in the church going, "Oh, you can't go to the bar. Nope, there's sin there." And I think, well, how did Jesus live? How did he border? How did he stay in the Word and yet hang out with sinners? He went to them. Where were they? Right? Where were they? They're in the fishing boats. It's true, they were. So go out to the fishing boats. Where are they now? So make sure you're there before them so they're not drunk when you tell them the message. And maybe they are, and God supernaturally sobers them up. Who are you? Are you a countercultural liver, but yet you're engaging culture? Verse 3, "Because of the privilege and authority God has given me, I give each of you this warning. Don't think you are better than you really are. Be honest in your evaluation of yourselves, measuring yourselves by the faith God has given us. Just as our bodies have many parts, and each part has a special function, so it is with Christ's body. We are many parts of one body, and we all belong to each other." Who are you? I'm so excited that you guys know you are children of God, but who are you in the family? Who you are in private, I'll say this multiple times today, who you are in private really defines who you are with Christ. If you are seeking God in private, then you are a seeker. If you are going to others on Christ's behalf, then you are an evangelist. And we're all commanded to do that. Aren't we? He didn't put a limit on who could go and tell the people about Jesus. He just said, go and do likewise. He didn't put a limit on who was supposed to teach them to obey the commands of God. He just said, go and do likewise. So we all have a responsibility to be evangelists and disciplers. If you don't believe that, just turn to Matthew. Start with verse 1 in chapter 1 and go through the entire thing. And then check out John. See what he has to say about the matter. And then check out Luke. And then end with Mark, just because his name's Mark. And we have two of them. You know? Who are you? Are you living in the confines of the word, but in the comfort zone of your life? Are you stepping out and going, I don't want to. Boom. You know, it's hard for someone to just go from here to here or from here to here. What's your comfort zone in this life? Knock it out of the way. Be the Babe Ruth of your life. Point where you're going to send it and send it. Okay. Sorry, I lost my spot. Don't laugh at me. In his grace, verse 6, God has given us different gifts for doing certain things well. So if God has given you the ability to prophesy, speak out with as much faith as God has given you. If your gift is to serve others, serve them well. If you are a teacher, teach well. If your gift is to encourage others, be encouraging. If it is giving, give generously. If God has given you leadership ability, take the responsibility seriously. And if you have a gift for showing kindness to others, do it gladly. Those are all edifying to others, aren't they? It's not just like an edification of self. I promise you, if you edify others, you will be edified yourself. Verse 9, don't just pretend to love others. Really love them. Hate what is wrong. It's okay to hate what's wrong, but it's not okay to hate people. Hold tightly to what is good. Love each other with genuine affection and take delight in honoring each other. Never be lazy, but work hard and serve the Lord enthusiastically. Rejoice in our confident hope. We've talked about confident hope. What's your confident hope based on? Your salvation in Jesus. You've already read the end of the book. You win. Go out with the confidence of salvation, the helmet of salvation, and say, Lord, I'm here. I'm ready. What you got for me today? Bring it on. Be patient in trouble and keep on praying. Verse 13, when God's people are in need, be ready to help them. Always be eager to practice hospitality. Dinner's ready. Come on over. Right? Mark and Coopy and I were driving by Connie's house because we were in McNabb, and I jokingly said, we should just stop in and see if dinner's ready. You know? We didn't, but yeah, she doesn't cook anymore, so we wouldn't have gotten anything. So now, always peanut butter sandwiches. Who are you? I mean, we read this and we see we're supposed to be these people for outreaching. I've always said this, don't give handouts. Give a helping hand. You're giving them a hand up. You're helping them out of a pit that they have fallen into. But you're not saying, here, take this and go, okay? That's a handout. You're saying, hey, here, let me help you. Come. Let me show you. And you help lift them out of a pit. When Peter sunk because of his faith into the water, Jesus didn't go, all right, so you can swim, right? All right, I gave you the ability to think again, so swim. No, he said, come here. He helped him out. You know? Are you helping people out or are you giving them handouts? Are you saying, hey, I am the guy who's giving generously and not giving anything else generously? You know? Here's all the money that you could ever want. You figure out what to do with it. How'd they get in the place where they didn't have any money anyway? Ask the questions. Yesterday we were at a leadership conference, and I've heard this time and time again. Ask good questions. I told someone once, I said, I always ask why. And they go, well, you'd never make it in my business. I looked at them and said, why? Not because I'm trying to be rebellious, or I just want to know why so I can buy into what you're doing. so I can be the best helper possible, so I can take you to the next level, the direction and mission that you've set before us. Why? Because God has called me to be the best me that I can be. And if I don't know what's going on, I don't know what direction to go. So how do I be the best me that God has made me to be? Well, we do this. We love people. We encourage them if we're called to encouragement. We lead people if we're called to leadership. We prophesy to someone with an encouraging word if we're called to prophesy. You don't go, oh, you're going to hell, blah, blah, blah. No. John 3:16 said God came to save the world. And then 17 says Jesus saved the world, right? He didn't come to condemn it. We teach our kids John 3:16 and they know it. But then John 3:17 comes around and they're like, well, I've always been taught John 3:16, so I know I'm going to hell. That's not what Jesus says. God sent his one and only son to die for us. Why? To condemn us? No. So who are you? Be what God has called you to be and what he's called everyone to be. Disciplers and evangelists, that's you. Ben, I'm scared. Good. That's that whole comfort zone thing coming into place. I say it. You remember being a teenager? No? You don't remember your growth spurts? Where you went from there to there in like a summer? I didn't have that. I grew 2 inches every year. But every year I had a little pain at some time or another. You remember your kids maybe talking about how much pain they were in at one point in their life? And it was growing. You want to grow in Christ? Get out of your comfort zone. Take on the pain. You grew physically, there was pain. You grow spiritually, there's going to be pain. Keep your focus on the Lord. Keep your helmet of salvation, the confidence of salvation on your head. You will make it. You will make it. It's okay to be uncomfortable. As a pastor friend of mine and a lot of psychologists say, it's okay to not be okay. God's, in this scripture, I love it because God's giving you the word on how to be more like him. On how to be more like him. Not how to be more like the person next to you. Not on how to be more like the cool kid on the block, the one that everybody wants to hang out with, but the one like him that everybody wants to hang out with. No, he's not giving you permission to go out and go sinning. He's saying, hey, you want to be more like me? Try this. I've given you a gift. Share it. You have a gift of healing? Do it. Don't just sit on it. You have a gift of prophesying? Do it. Don't just sit on it. If it's there to edify someone else and God, use it. If it's there to edify yourself, use it at home. You're not around anybody else there. You know what I'm saying? Are you wanting to be the person God's created you to be? Who are you? Yeah, digging into his word is great. But that's also like that comfort zone thing where you dig but don't share. It's like making dinner for yourself, but your family's sitting there going, I'm hungry too. You know? It's like sending your kid to the park and going, go have fun. And I'm speaking to David. David looks at me and goes, I want to go to the park. Okay, go. You know? No, Dad, I want to go with you. But I don't go. You know what I'm saying? No, we need to go. We need to go. 1 Samuel 16:6 through 13 says this. It says this. When they arrived, Samuel took one look at Eliab and thought, surely this is the Lord's anointed. One look, and he had him. This is what God says, verse 7. But the Lord said to Samuel, don't judge by his appearance or height, for I have rejected him. The Lord doesn't see things the way you see them. People judge by outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart. Where's your heart? Who's your heart? Then Jesus told his son Abinadab to step forward and walk in front of Samuel. But Samuel said, this is not the one the Lord has chosen. Next, Jesse summons Shimeah. But Samuel said, neither is this one the Lord has chosen. In the same way, all seven of Jesse's sons were presented to Samuel. But Samuel said to Jesse, the Lord has not chosen any of these. Then Samuel asked, are these all the sons you have? They're still the youngest, Jesse replied. But he's out in the fields watching the sheep and goats. Send for him at once, Samuel said. We will not sit down to eat until he arrives. So Jesse sent for him. He was dark and handsome, with beautiful eyes, and the Lord said, this is the one, anoint him. So as David stood there among his brothers, Samuel took the flask of olive oil he had brought and anointed David with the oil. And the Spirit of the Lord came powerfully upon David. From that day on, then Samuel returned to Ramah. Samuel was mistaken. No. I don't know if you heard that. The spirit within inside Samuel was mistaken. But when the spirit came from God, he was right. Are you operating in the spirit of God when you go? Are you waiting to get your spiritual fill here and then maybe at home? And then maybe the next morning, and the next morning, and you're overflowing. It's like this. If you only read the word, you're going to dry up. If you only activate in the spirit, you're going to blow up. But if you have a good balance of the word and the spirit, you're going to grow up. You hear that? Are we operating in the word and the spirit? Are we word rooted, spirit alive? Are you allowing the Holy Spirit to direct you? I'm thinking of a scripture where Peter and John are walking through the gate, beautiful, and they've been doing it day in and day out, you know? They've walked by the same people for a month, we'll say, right? And all of a sudden, the same guy that they've walked by for 30 days, sitting there, and the anointing of God rests on him, and John looks over and goes, there he is, let's pray. They're going to be late for prayer. Come in late, Mark. I don't care. Come in late. I don't care. Go do the Lord's business. If you're late because you're doing the Lord's business, you're forgiven. If you're late just because, you're forgiven. It doesn't matter. See, this is fellowship. But isn't going out and sharing the gospel just as important? If it's this early in the morning, you're sharing the gospel, more power to you. Who's out this early on a Sunday morning? They're all trying to get over their hangovers. If you come across one that has a hangover, pray it out of them. Seriously, pull them aside and pray it out of them. And say, that's from Jesus. He wants to say, you're loved. Something's causing them to go out and get drunk every night. Pray it out of them. You're loved. Love everyone, right? Who are you? Child of God. Yes, there's a lot that is encompassed with that answer. Who are you specifically as a child of God? You've all watched war movies, right? No, I'm not going to share that one. Two people got that. You've all watched movies, right, with heroes? There's a hero in a movie. Maybe they're an unexpected hero. 99% of the time, there's a part in the movie where this is different. Okay, Mark, this is different. I had this written like days ago. I'm not even kidding. So there's this story about war movies and how you have a general and you have this and that. Yeah. Anyway, Mark and Koopy were with me and we heard that story together. But you have these hero movies, right? And in the movie, there's a part in the movie where the hero gets down. He's just, she or he is just like, I don't know if I can do it. I just don't know. And there's a motivational spot. And all of a sudden, the tide of the movie completely turns. Now, think about this. The movie is your life. And you are that hero. But we've lived inside the confines of our comfort zone. In the word, about God's business, in our comfort zone. But God's saying, let me motivate you to the edge. And something happens inside your spirit where it motivates you to the edge. Your movie represents your entire life here on earth. The last half of that movie has yet to be written. Are you going to be motivated to change the world? This is a sermon I would preach to students. Think, I was thinking, I'm preaching this to adults and we have to be changers of the world. I'm like, I don't know how I would take this. But yet God is asking you not to expect what you normally expect, but change the world. In order to do that, you have to change the world. How do you do that? Well, we just read how to do that in Romans. You know, sometimes that motivation, there's a fight, you know, a fight within ourselves. We've been motivated, but we're like, God, not me. No, not me. You've picked the wrong guy, God. You've made a mistake. Anybody ever say that before? I'll tell you this. God told me I was going to be a pastor through people that didn't believe. In my school, they looked at me and said, you're going to do exactly what your dad does. And I go, nope, not me. Joke's on me. See, God has called you into a specific something. You're still here on this earth, aren't you? Maybe you haven't hit it yet. God's not finished. Jesus is still working. He hasn't retired. And to be honest, I don't think I find retirement in the Bible. You don't either, do you? You're not retired. You've told me that. You've got more, right? Farmers, do you retire ever? No, especially during the summer, except to sleep. Motivation draws the best out of us, doesn't it? Are you motivated when you read the word, or you just feel like, oh, God, why did you have to bring that up? I love when preachers preach and I get angry. Like, why are they saying that? Because afterwards, I don't confront the pastor. I go and confront myself. Why did I get angry? What is it with inside myself? So if I step on your toes, I do it with pride. Found in God. Because there's something in your life that's looking to change. And that's why we get angry. I'm no different than you. And let's be honest, you're no different than me, other than some of you are female and some of you are male. See, the males and I, we're the same. No, we're all tall. Some of us are taller than me in Christ. The best you is the same you that's the worst you. Do you understand that? The best you is the same as the worst you, but it's who you choose to be today that makes the difference. See, you're still you, no matter if you choose to be the worst you or the best you today. Do you know that? You're still Sharon if you choose to be the worst you or the best you today. If you choose to follow Christ today or choose not to today. And Jesus still says, I love you. Even when you put him on the cross today, he looks at you and goes, I love you. You're forgiven. Just come back. But who are you today? See, who are you is not an answer that you look for forever. Yes, it is. There's a bigger picture, but you also have to break it down to the smaller things in the picture. Your days, your years, your months. Who am I today, God? Choose him to be the best you can be. Psalms 139, 13 through 16 says this. It says, "You made all the delicate inner parts of my body and knit me together in my mother's womb. Thank you for making me so wonderfully complex. Your workmanship is marvelous. How well I know it. You watched me as I was being formed in utter seclusion, as I was woven together in the dark of the womb. You saw me before I was born. Every day of my life was recorded in your book. Every moment was laid out before a single day had passed." God created you with something in mind. You. You were that something. The people around you are that something. The souls you come in contact with are that something. So who are you? You are wonderfully complex. You are wonderfully made. God's good, isn't he? Obviously, he's good all the time if he's good today, because he's never changing. But we change day to day. When you try to be someone other than what God has called you to be, you are rejecting God in you. Do you know that? When you try to be someone other than who God has chosen you to be, you reject God. You reject his power in your life. You reject him. You say, "God, no, not me. No, I don't want that. I'm not okay with that, God. No." Jonah rejected God, didn't he? Yeah, he ended up smelling like fish puke. What do you smell like today? Go ahead and get that video ready. We're not ready for it yet, but just so everybody's kind of there. I said something last week, and it was a quote from A.W. Tozer. And it's just as true today as it was last week. I won't have the quote written down, but God looks in you daily to find yourself. Let's pause it. Sorry. So, cool. All right. It's number two, not one. So it ends where the other one left off. So this is right, I think. So sorry I interrupted this. But God daily looks in you to see if he finds himself. Do you know that? And halfway through the day, guess what he does? He calls you by name and says, oh, where am I? That really does answer the who am I today question. Is God finding himself in you right now? Is he seeing himself in your life? Is he saying, "There I am, child of God. There I am, child of God. There I am, child of God. I'm reigning today. I'm reigning today." See, it's not who you are that matters. It's whose you are. Is he saying to you right now, "I'm there, right there today. I reign today in the grocery store. There I am. I reign today in the coffee shop. There I am. I reign today in the bars, in the liquor stores, in the Menards. There I am today, reigning in that household. There I am, invading the lives of others around me and breaking the hearts for what breaks me." God is saying, you know, last week was tear off the roof and it was the last week, but he's saying, "Hey, let's rip this roof off now, because you belong in my kingdom. How many people like mischief? Roberta, raise your hand. How many people really, you know, like you like getting in trouble every now and then? Really? No one likes getting in trouble? I mean, let's be honest. I love it. I'm like, can I get in trouble today? Let's find out. That's mischief, right? You want to live on the edge? You want to live a dangerous life for Christ? Be about the mischief. You know what I'm saying? You want to know who you are? Get to the edge and you'll find out exactly who you are right now, right in this moment. Allow the Holy Spirit to direct you to the edge because he's got you. You can even do the whole Titanic thing, you know, where, you know, Kate and what's his name, Jack, are leaning out and they're like, I'm the king of the world. But instead of a railing, it's God. I've got this, God. Thank you. There I am. Just reigning in that life today. Oh, who are you? No, whose are you?